There's sometimes a buggy, irresponsible opinions about classic film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's the July 2023 special subject, film Noirlsons by Phil Karlson. So exciting to see episodes we planned years ago coming up on the calendar.
Yep, just the same way we hasten toward our death.
But no, this is a joyous occasion. We'll be talking about Kansas City Confidential, 99 River Street, Five Against the House, and the Phenix City Story, movies made between 1952 and 1955, sort of at the height of Phil Karlson's career. Before we start talking about the movies themselves, maybe we should have a little biographical information about our auteur.
What do you know about Phil Karlson, Dave?
I know that he came up the hard way, you know, as a technician, maybe, and assistant director. He certainly didn't start at a big studio. Even these movies, they're mostly made by minor players in Hollywood, but he got stars to work with, the realization of a dream for him, no doubt, after an indifferent beginning.
Well, to fill in some of those gaps with Wikipedia, he was born Phil Karlson.
What year?
1908.
Okay.
He studied painting at Chicago's Art Institute, also tried to make a living as a song and dance man, and then eventually studied law before doing odd jobs at Universal Pictures while he was studying law. Obviously, it comes up several times in these movies. Like, I think 3 out of 4 of the films, somebody's studying law.
That's true.
So he was doing odd jobs at Universal, started working as a gag man as well, sold gags to Buster Keaton, dropped out of law school, and got into assistant directing at Universal. He worked on Destry Rides Again.
Oh, cool.
Mystery of Edwin Drood.
I really like that movie.
Tons of things. Seven Sinners, Flame in New Orleans. So lots of the... He was there during the Marlena Dietrich era, I guess. It started with Eve.
Cool. Deanna Durbin.
He became friends with Abbott and Costello, pitched some more gags to Lou Costello. So he just did all sorts of things, but eventually he moved to Monogram Pictures, also as an assistant director, and then just started directing, because obviously this was one of the Poverty Row Studios, so he got a crack at directing there. Moved over to Columbia.
So he was really busy in the 40s making movies that we mostly have never heard of.
His first one, A Wave, A Whack, and A Marine, he called probably the worst film ever made. That was his opinion.
We'll have to validate that sometime. So he was a song and dance man, and it looks like he made a bunch of musical type things. Ultimately, he would make his name as a director of tough pictures.
Right. Many of the things I read about him online talk about how he really gets his big chance in the 1950s with these pictures because the nature of Poverty Row Studios is changing. You know, the whole film industry is changing in the 50s. The role of B pictures is no longer to do what a B picture traditionally would do, which is support the main feature. Gareth Hedges.
Friend of the podcast.
Friend of the pod. Your co-host on the
Red Time for Bonzo.
Aborted Reagan series.
Well, we got pretty far, but then everyone moved in different towns and it was hard to record because we have no technical abilities. Could still find those episodes on the feed, however.
So he did a lot of research on Karlson.
He's a recognized scholarly expert on Phil Karlson and especially the Phenix City story and Walking Tall.
So he talks about how these Poverty Row studios were getting more ambitious in certain ways in the 1950s to try to appeal to a new audience since B-movies no longer had their traditional role. Allied artists who took over Monogram Studios, they're the ones who made the Phenix City Story. They were trying to become a mini-major studio, he says. A way to do that would be by making sort of topical pseudo-documentary fact-based crime films that would excite an audience, attract an audience, not on a huge scale, but enough to make it worthwhile, enough to make you a mini major.
Yeah, Gareth talks a lot about how several of these movies, especially Kansas City Confidential and even more so Phenix City Story, they come out of the era of the Kefauver Commission, Estes Kefauver, and these inquiries into municipal corruption, getting tough with organized crime, running all these towns across America.
So these movies have better production values than Poverty Row movies had previously for this reason. Of course, they're competing with early television, so they're doing it in a very different way from the spectacular Technicolor movies and VistaVision and Panoramic films of the major studios.
And all of them have recognizable stars in them, except, I guess, Phenix City Story, which has important character actors, people that would be known, but our leading players are not names on the level of Guy Madison or Kim Novak or John Payne.
Well, Kim Novak wasn't much of a name at the time she made Five Against the House.
No, but she's amazing and was on the road to becoming a star. And let's hear from Leonard Maltin and his TV, movies, and video guide. 1991 edition. Kansas City Confidential is our first film chronologically, and he gives it 3 stars out of a possible 4. Tough action drama with ex-con Payne nailed for armored robbery he didn't commit, determined to expose cunning mastermind Foster. Silly wrap-up scene is the only detraction. Director Phil Karlson and the cast list: John Payne, Colleen Gray, Preston Foster, Neville Brand, Lee Van Cleef, and Jack Elam. That is a personality plus cast. Karlson gets a lot of mileage out of those various hoodlums, especially.
So what can we say generally about these films? I did agree with consensus from what I read online that 99 River Street and The Phenix City Story are probably his best films, according to what I read online, but the best of this bunch that we watched.
I'd have to really think about that. I love all of these movies.
Those ones definitely stood out for me.
You can see the auteur stamp, I think, on all of them, but each one is quite individual. They're not assembly line productions. They've got very different features, one from the other. One thing that does unify them, though, is unflinching presentation of violence. However, none of them is nihilistic. They're all extremely hopeful, in a way. Every single one of them ends on a kind of uplifting coda, which, in this case, Maltin finds ludicrous, but it's there, and it's clearly not an anomaly. It's going to be repeated in the other 3.
I think we talked about the hyperviolence in Anthony Mann's movies. You can find it sprinkled throughout the noir era, hyperviolent scenes even in the 1940s noirs, but generally speaking, we're getting more and more violent as we're heading into the 50s. Less glamorous femme fatales and more just violence and crime. Obviously, that's a huge feature of these films, and I found myself asking as we went on watching them, is this just an exploitative ploy to attract sadistic audience members? And yes, it is, but also it becomes clear as you're watching the films that violence is the subject of them, and masculine violence in particular becomes the subject, and then that broadens out more to be a social violence in Phenix City Story, right? Allied with, particularly in 99 River Street and in Five Against the House, with male hysteria. Now, male hysteria is a very familiar noir subject, but it's interesting to have in these movies that hysteria linked with hyperviolence and rage. I think we have to at least refer to the problem of how do you even define film noir? Like, these don't look like film noirs anymore. There's not the same use of contrasting black and white.
Kansas City Confidential and 99 River Street are both very interesting.
Yes, they're
shadowed
productions. They're visually interesting, but I feel like there's more emphasis on light, and that's also contributed to by the fact that location shooting is becoming easier in the 50s. I guess it's probably especially with small productions. There's a lot of location shooting. There's a lot of natural light.
Mm-hmm.
The darks aren't as dark as they used to be, and there's not the same sort of visual expressionism. There's some distorted shots of faces, particularly in Kansas City Confidential, because the one actor who has a face that just
Jackie Lamb
calls for it. Yeah, they look visually different from 40s noirs. And they're different in their subjects, too, as I was saying. What is to stop these from just being crime films? Is it the fact that the central male characters are so emotionally disturbed? Is that one of the differences?
Primary subject of film noir, and Phil Karlson is one of the greatest explorers of that territory.
Of course, you can have emotionally disturbed gangsters, but when you do, often those films are called film noirs as well, like
White Heat. Now, I want to just lay out the plot of Kansas City Confidential before we get into the details. We start out following Preston Foster, who is a criminal mastermind, and he has devised this scheme to hire three hoods that don't know each other, or kind of blackmail them into helping him, also offering the carrot of a huge payoff. They're gonna wear masks, they won't know each other. It seems like it's gonna be Reservoir Dogs.
The first time you see Preston Foster in that mask, it's such a simple mask, but it's so weird. It's just really surreal moment. It's really creepy.
Yeah. Everything kind of goes according to plan. Unfortunately, the plan involves framing a florist, a floral delivery man, for the heist, because they're going to insinuate themselves into the daily life of this block and just step out of the back of a duplicate florist truck and grab the money from some Brinks guards. It all works out, and the cops, taking the easy route, grab John Payne, the florist, and beat the fuck out of him for several days.
He's a very short-tempered, frustrated man from the time we first see him. As soon as they nab him and start rummaging through the back of his florist's truck, he's physically fighting back with the cops. And of course, one is trained from both the news and movies to be like, don't do that! What are you doing? Don't do that! That's like the absolute wrong thing to do.
Okay, but he's righteously angry here.
I'm not saying it's immoral to fight back with cops. I'm saying it's unwise.
Yeah, well, he's been through the prison system already, we find out. So that's a big strike against him. He's an ex-con. He got into trouble over gambling debts. And the movie really dwells on the interrogation process. Complete lawlessness, the law exemplifies here. And when they finally realize, okay, well, actually, we found the duplicate truck. You were telling the truth all along. He gets a very curt, well, sorry, these things happen. He's also been fired from his job just for being arrested. The guy is at his wit's end. He's got nothing left. He's been trying to rebuild his life as a florist. That's over. His last straw that he clutches at is, maybe I can figure out what the hell happened and clear myself. So you've almost got like a Hitchcock plot.
So can we talk about John Payne for a moment, Dave?
An amazing actor. I've always loved John Payne. He's great in the 40s as a genial, although sometimes cranky, song and dance man or partner to the Fox Blonde. He's great in Miracle on 34th Street. In the late 40s and through most of the 50s, he rebranded himself as a tough guy. And of course, he is a tough guy. I mean, he was a boxer and wrestler before becoming a movie star. He certainly is convincingly brutish if he needs to be.
He's 40 here. It's amazing because he was a leading man, but not like a huge leading man. You know, a supporting leading man to leading ladies at Fox, right? We've talked about how his character is often a bit of a cad in those movies, but here he no longer, it's not just that he's a tough guy. He no longer looks like a leading man. He looks like a schlub. He looks like an ordinary 40-year-old man who's been living a hard life. Like, it's this combination of his ability to be tough and the fact that he looks emotionally weak.
No, I mean, these are brave performances by John Payne, I think. He's really committing to this, and he needs to have both of those things.
He does not look glamorous. I mean, obviously he's still a movie star, and therefore whenever you say these things about 99.9% of movie stars, there's always the caveat that they still look better than most ordinary human beings. He gives the impression of looking like a worn out, downtrodden ordinary human being.
Yeah, he takes a hell of a beating. He's determined to take this chance, and when he gets a lead that there may be something going on down in Mexico, he grabs it. That's the last we see of Kansas City, so Kansas City Confidential is kind of a misleading title. Most of the movie takes place in Mexico. We've already met all the hoodlums, and the weirdest of them all is Jack Elam. Always great, and here he is just the sweatiest, most coked up looking maniac you've ever seen.
Bugged out insect eyes.
John Payne is told, go down to Tijuana, look for the weirdest fucking eyes you've ever seen. Can't miss him. Just hang out at some gambling dens. And that punt for him, I really love that. John Payne asked the cab driver for some information on where games of chance might take place. Spends like half the night, but they find their quarry. John Payne starts hassling Jack Elam, betting against him at the crap table.
When Preston Foster originally approached Jack Elam,
he slapped him around.
And Jack Elam told him as he was leaving that he doesn't usually slap around that easy. But it turns out he does.
Well, he keeps coming up against these much bigger guys. Bad luck here. Just be outmatched every time. And Preston Foster was a movie star in the 30s as well. And of course, his performance is terrific in its own right. I don't want to underestimate that. He's got a lot of dimensions to his character that emerge toward the end of the film, especially. John Payne gets the drop on Jack Elam for good, knocks the information out of him. Everyone's always taking guns away from everyone else in this movie. Having a gun does not seem to be the cure-all that Second Amendment makes it seem to be.
Well, not when everyone else has a gun.
No, but a lot of times the unarmed person gets the better of the person with the gun because they're overconfident. It seems to happen over and over again in this movie. And
wow,
not,
you really analyzed this.
Yeah, and not only to the bad guys, right? It even happens to John Payne once. He's all of a sudden too cocky when he's got the gun and they take it off of him. But yeah, Jack Elam, born to lose. They've got these signifier cards that they're supposed to bring. A half king playing card. John Payne says, I'm taking this. I'm taking all of your documentation. This we're partners now.
Felt like a Twin Peaks The Return moment, but I'm sure playing cards have been used in a million gangster films. And this is the movie that has Winkies in it too, isn't it? They were in the war together.
Saved his life in Iwo Jima. And of course, that's a big part of all of these movies too. The camaraderie and the damage that was sustained by these men who fought either in World War II or in Korea.
But his friend has a brother who seems to be a gangster who owns this diner, but he's a nice gangster, which is not something we're going to see a lot of in Carlson's movies, but here there's a nice gangster who helps him out and wishes him well.
Yeah, well, because of that bond. And he got a raw deal from the cops.
That's true. This is not a cop-friendly movie.
No, it's really not. It's hard to think of many movies that make the cops look worse than this.
The Phenix City Story, maybe.
Yeah, but those are
Southern cops.
That we're kind of used to. The whole town is corrupt and taken over by, it's basically the Klan is running the police. We've seen that before. But this is, they're not even corrupt in that way. I'm sure they probably are, but they're not doing it for that reason. They are just sadists who are beating anyone that gets anywhere near them. For the sheer fun of it, it seems. Not being ordered to do it by some kind of grand dragon or anything. It's just a matter of course. And then they're like, well, sorry, and let him go after he's been dismissed from his florist job. They're about to set off together on the plane to the ultimate destination where the split of the money is supposed to take place. Jack Elam, again, completely unable to blend into the surroundings. Some cops see him, gun him down. These cops, they yell, cops, so that he will reach for something and then blow him away. That's basically a game for them. They don't even want to have the hassle of bringing him in. And again, that's not because he knows anything. It's not some kind of assassination to protect information. It's just because this is a gleeful part of their day. We can kill this guy if we just make it seem like he was reaching for a gun. So John Payne's on his own, and there's some very tense moments where he watches as they all circle around the body, and he has to stick around because he's worried that Jack Elam's final statement is going to be that guy over there, he's got my playing card or something, but he doesn't. He's too dead for that. So Payne gets on the plane using Jack Elam's name. Pete Harris?
Yeah.
So this is amazing too, right? Because John Payne, he's very resourceful, very likable, I find, in this movie, but his plan is not well thought out because he's going to meet these guys for a split of the money. He knows that Mr. Big does know who the guys behind the masks were, and he's just figuring, I'm going to get in the mix here and I'm going to expose this racket somehow and vindicate myself. I'm not sure how he's exactly planning to do that.
He's very confident in his superheroic powers.
He is very effective up to a point, but as we'll find out, only the fact that Mr. Big is not exactly the nihilistic criminal that we thought he might be saves him, because John Payne should be dead at the end of this movie. Now, Maltin didn't like that. I love it. So we get a lot of lounging around this seedy resort with a bunch of guys sitting around in the heat playing poker, sweating, flirting.
Oh, in addition to the hyper-violence, the touch that Carlson most likes to employ, the pulpy touch, is the sweatiest-faced men I have ever seen in a movie.
This is not glamour. Lee Van Cleef, who's probably most famous these days as the bad in The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. He's the kind of playboy Italian character, Tony Romano, right. Neville Brand is the kind of
surly,
real lunkhead.
Silent.
I know him best from DOA. He plays Chester, the guy that sort of giggles and talks about shooting him in the belly all the time. He doesn't like it in the belly.
Now, it's very hard to take these two seriously, but it turns out that when they gang up, they're very effective at violence, and they have somehow formed a very strong attachment in this short period of time.
Yeah, well, they're pretty nervous, right? They're trying to figure out who is who, who's going to have this money. They know it's an easier split if you kill people off, so why would anyone allow these other guys to live? Just because of a deal made in Kansas City? You know, I wouldn't feel too confident about that. So they've kind of teamed up like people on Survivor, planning to backstab each other later, as we see they in fact do. And John Payne claims to be part of the gang, and he has the card. Tony was driving the truck, so you could believe that he would not realize that John Payne wasn't on the truck. The other guy was in there, and he would have to know that Jack Elam doesn't have the same build at all as John Payne. They're not the same guy. They start trying to figure out who the hell this is. Is he a cop? Is he just some creep that ran into Jack Elam and killed him? That's not exactly what happened, but it certainly easily could have. They're working against each other.
What about Mr. Big and his daughter?
Yeah, well, that's another amazing X factor in this film. You've got Preston Foster. We find out he's a retired policeman, and he was retired forcibly due to politics, they say. Now, we don't find out exactly what the politics were. Maybe he was trying to clean up that town and make the police stop beating everyone up for no reason. We don't know. I could kind of believe that.
We know from the biggest hit that Karlson ever made, which was in the 1970s, we know that on the one hand, he despises the police, and on the other hand, he romanticizes the lawman.
Well, Buford Pusser is a different story, yeah.
But if you hear him talk about that character, he does definitely romanticize the character and the idea of there being a good lawman.
And it could be that, right? But that's all left totally ambiguous. You can imagine anything. Maybe he was the most corrupt guy and got kicked out, or he was the least corrupt guy and got kicked out. Seems more the latter because he's such a kindly, upstanding dad.
And his daughter is studying law, which is not something terribly usual in movies or real life at this period. I would say particularly in the 1950s, as gender roles are getting more locked down.
Yeah, that's right. And now it starts to come into focus what his plan was all along. These newly minted bills, the serial numbers are known. He tells the guys that they've got to wait a while and split the money once they're in Mexico. Even there, it's not really going to work out. And then we find out that he doesn't care. He's using all of this as a prop. He never intends to spend a cent of this money. He's going to put it on a boat and then report them to the insurance company and get them all arrested, and he gets a reward and maybe gets back on the force.
Now, of course, we find out as soon as his daughter appears that she has made all of this moot. She has put her studies to use.
Got an appeal set up for him.
Right. And so he didn't have to become this actually corrupt ex-cop just in order to make himself a hero and get back on the force.
Yeah. And again, his idea was, you know, we pull off this caper, nobody gets hurt, and ultimately these three criminals that I hate get arrested. One of them's a cop killer. You know, he really doesn't like these guys and he doesn't mind burning them down in quest of his reprieve.
The daughter immediately takes a liking to the fake Pete Harris. So that throws a monkey wrench in everybody's plans.
You gotta love when she talks about how I had this amazing co-passenger on the plane in, Pete Harris. And Preston Foster's like, what the fuck? Jack Elam dating my daughter? No way. Then it turns out, of course, it's not that Pete Harris at all.
But that's almost worse.
I love Colleen Gray. She's in so many good movies.
I haven't seen enough of this type of noir to know, but she always plays a nice girl in the film noirs.
Yeah, you want to think back to the biggest movies she's in, like Nightmare Alley. She's the electrifying girl. Kiss of Death, an amazing movie as well. She plays Victor Mature's wife in that one. She never played a femme fatale. She's always radiating goodness. And here she is too, but she's more involved in the plot than usual. I really like the scene where she wanders into John Payne's room.
Well, she saves him from being
exactly
killed because he's being absolutely pummeled by these guys.
Yeah, I mean, right there he was dead. So she intercedes at at that point, and she knows what's going on. She doesn't know exactly what's going on, but she knows there was some roughhousing happening there. She's not fooled.
She knows he's involved with bad guys.
Yeah, and she found his gun lying on the lawn. Again, this is brave stuff to have this hero that we're all rooting for. He's not infallible. He's committing all kinds of errors in this movie. He's really a regular guy who is battle-trained from Iwo Jima and twice the size of me, so he can fight with people, but he doesn't have supernatural senses. He can get ambushed. He can get fucked up by these enemies.
It's definitely an auteur touch of these movies to involve the love interest more than a standard amount in the plot. Have her take some kind of action, or at least show some kind of courage.
And I think the best scene between Payne and Gray is, I think they develop a nice chemistry in the movie, and when he really pulls out all the stops to make her go away because he feels like he's on a collision course with hell and it's not going to work out. She talks about how she's going to take care of him and fix things for him, and he's like, fuck off. He sells the moment really well on the multiple levels, because you can see it's paining him greatly to say these things, but he manages to make her back off, although not completely, because she's pretty persistent. The fact that she has fallen so hard for this guy does have an effect on Preston Foster, and she actually goes to him and says, help him, please help Peter Harris, he's in big trouble. The reason he's in big trouble is because he's fallen into Foster's trap. That all goes unspoken, and you don't know what Foster's going to do when he drives up. But right there again, Payne was dead. He had walked up with a gun, got it taken off him, and they were going to kill him right there until the fisherman drives up in his truck and offers a ride, and they all get in.
Yeah, he really doesn't have any kind of plan at all.
No.
I guess you could say that's a failing of the movie. It doesn't matter, though, because it's dramatically interesting.
No, I don't think that's a failing of the movie. I think we're supposed to understand that John Payne is over his head, way over his head.
Well, his feeling is that, I guess that he will never get a job again unless... Yeah. Unless he does this thing.
He has to succeed, but he's not going to. That's the thing. Unless these feelings of love and family loyalty kind of intercede on his behalf. It's still up in the air because Foster does go ahead with his plan. He drops the three guys off at the boat, signals to the insurance man who knows him, and this is all going off exactly as planned. Could have just sat back and waited, but he doesn't. He gets on the boat where Payne, again, he's resourceful. He gets away from the two guys, but not completely. The two team players fall out.
Payne does that on purpose.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter. He's still got a gun on him. He's gonna die next. Why split it two ways when you can split it one way? And Preston Foster gets on the boat and gets involved when he doesn't need to, and gets shot himself. Then it becomes Payne's opportunity to conceal Foster's part in all of this. And he certainly better do it, because otherwise, Preston Foster could have got off scot-free with all of this.
Comic book classic ending where you have to conceal the bad thing that the good man did.
That's right. And it's happily ever after, which Maltin apparently doesn't like. What a sourpuss.
John Payne gets a reward, so I guess he can set himself up in business or whatever, and I guess Colleen Gray is going to study law, or maybe Phil Karlson quit and do something more fun. Who knows?
It seems like that's what they're on track for, and the bank gets their money back. And the insurance company doesn't have to raise their rates.
Everybody wins.
Except for the three dead guys on the boat. 99 River Street. Maltin gives this one 3 stars as well, out of a possible 4. Rugged crime caper, with Payne caught up in tawdry surroundings, trying to prove himself innocent of murder charge. Unpretentious film really packs a punch. Director Phil Karlson, and the cast list: John Payne, Evelyn Keyes, Brad Dexter, Peggy Castle, Ian Wolfe, Frank Phelan.
I actually thought this movie was fairly pretentious, if by pretentious you mean sophisticated.
It's got postmodern aspects to it.
Well, when I was reading up on it, somebody somewhere mentioned that it's part of that everything happens to a guy in one night subgenre of noir. Dark Night of the Soul, I guess.
It starts out with John Payne watching himself losing the heavyweight championship of the world bout.
While I was watching it, I thought of After Hours, which I guess might be the ultimate meta example of that type of noir. This is a pretty good encapsulation, I guess, of Phil Karlson's type of noir. The mixture of the hyper-violence with the masochism. The protagonist put in this horrifying loser position. Not only is he watching himself lose in the crucial moment when his life became a failure, but his
wife is castrating him.
His hot wife is making scathing comments on it as she stands behind behind him.
You enjoying watching yourself getting beaten to a pulp while we sit here in this dump? Unique beginning to a film. John Payne, he's on track. He is going to be heavyweight champion of the world. He's so close. He's definitely winning that bout.
He could have been a contender.
Then his eye gets cut and he can't see anything and he's just getting beaten senseless and he doesn't even get a chance to tough it out. They're like, no, your eye's cut. Technical knockout. That's it. He's not allowed to fight ever again. The boxing commission banned him from the game. This is all he knows how to do. He's a cab driver now. Is that a step up or step down from florist?
I'm thinking that guy was a delivery guy for a florist.
Yeah, I know.
So I think taxi driver is probably half a step up from that.
He's hacking for a living. Meanwhile, his wife has a sparkling jewel on her wrist. She says it's costume jewelry. Seems like maybe it isn't. John Payne really wants to believe that she's not two-timing him with gangsters.
Yeah, it's interesting because he's ticking time bomb and yet he's not paranoiacally jealous.
He gets jealous when he sees her making out with a gangster at her place of work. So that's fair enough.
This movie has a lot of different interesting tones to it. So we see his friend who works at the, you know, just he's a dispatcher at the cab company.
Well, that's Frank Phelan. And of course, his most famous role is Ernie the cab driver in It's a Wonderful Life.
He is a really wonderful guy. He, I guess, has never had the ambitions.
Well, he was the trainer, right? So they know each other going way, way back. He was John Payne's trainer. He was in his corner during the fights. And now they're working at this taxi company together.
So he couldn't go on and train anybody else?
No, it's a real personal relationship.
Well, regardless of whether he had the same ambitions, then it's probably not quite the same to be the trainer as to be the guy in the ring.
No.
He has settled much more easily into this life, and he and his wife are happy.
They've got a kid. John Payne is an uncle, honorary uncle.
He's just a sweet and wonderful and optimistic guy who keeps giving very good, very normal advice to John Payne that nevertheless...
It just doesn't work when you're married to that evil monster.
Yeah, it's just not going to work. It's a little bit too optimistic for the reality of his situation.
Yeah.
I don't know. I didn't think she was that bad. To me, this just looked like a marriage that would have worked fine if they'd gotten what they'd wanted.
Yeah, no, but she really loses her moral compass completely. I mean, she's not just involved with a gangster. She is an accessory to a murder and all kinds of theft and crimes. She's out of control.
Fair enough. She has gone down a bad path here with her involvement with this gangster. I just thought that aspect of the marriage was interesting. What was she going to be to him? She was going to be a trophy wife.
He makes it pretty clear that I'm sure he loved her, but it wasn't this deep thing. It was just, I'm the heavyweight boxer, you're the showgirl, you know, we're the kind of couple that society envisions getting together.
It's like a working class version of the marriage in The Enchanted Cottage, a marriage that does not come off.
But no, there are definitely greater ambitions there on both sides. And for her, she's still got everything she had as a showgirl, so she should be capitalizing on it.
Yeah, but not with this gangster. He really is just a complete sociopath.
This is one of the most evil characters I've ever seen.
So, like I said, this movie has a full spectrum from really wonderful people to not so great, like average people who've gone down a bad path, to super, super evil people, and then this completely desperate protagonist.
Yeah, and let's not forget Evelyn Keyes, who's a very interesting character in her own right. She commits a pretty egregious breach of friendship.
This, too, is, as he even says, it's a little lesson in ambition that she gets. So she is also tempted the way that his wife was tempted, but she goes in a different direction.
I love the way she kind of atones for it. She shows up later and she's like, yeah, I was a heel, wasn't I? Just don't get characters like this who commit such a terrible act and then she comes back from it. Usually women in film noir, they're one or the other, or they were doing something because they were really under threat of violence or something. She just did it out of, yeah, I want to be in this play. On the worst night of John Payne's life, I'm gonna make his life a million times worse.
Well, let's talk about this whole sequence because this is the most important relationship in any of these movies. It's the most fully depicted relationship, romantic relationship. It seems to represent an auteur ideal for Karlson because
I agree.
You see kind of fragments of it in the love relationships in the other movies. So it's just, they're just casually introduced as acquaintances who seem to have met, if I'm not mistaken, at this coffee shop that they both frequent late at night.
Clearly, they really like each other, and they obviously have a lot of feelings they haven't admitted to themselves because he's married. But all of that comes to a boil when there's supposedly a body to be disposed of.
Right, so we first are introduced to her and what we think we're seeing. This movie's almost De Palma-esque, really. What we think we're seeing is this nice, sweet girl who just really needs to get a break on Broadway and has this opportunity. And when she talks about meeting this producer late at night, we know that trope. We have a feeling where this is going to go, and we're feeling bad for her, right?
And the people that wrote the play also know that trope.
And he's been giving her free cab rides now and then. This is how they've formed a bond. She clearly just thinks of him as a nice guy, nice enough. She can appeal to him and he will help her out. A nice guy, maybe a nice guy who's a little bit sexually interested in her, maybe has a little crush on her or something. He's a patsy.
Yeah.
He's her patsy, right? But we have been so convinced by her performance of niceness and by the framing of her as a female type in this movie, as a trope, that we are not suspecting anything at all. And also it's a kind of weird murder mystery that might happen in a movie like this. But we've seen this before. Might have been a Jean Arthur movie. There's some kind of staged murder.
Adventure in Manhattan.
Adventure in Manhattan. It was a Jean Arthur movie, right? This is the same idea.
He goes with her to this funeral, right? Joel McRae.
Yeah, I couldn't remember the details of it.
But it's all staged. It's not real, yeah.
But similarly, the thing that's similar about it, same kernel of idea, is that when Evelyn Keyes gives this performance describing the sexual assault that led her to committing murder, you can feel that she's giving a performance, just like Jean Arthur's character in that movie. It's not quite good enough. And I'm watching it and I'm like, she's not doing a great job here. But the material itself is so inherently sympathetic that you don't want to be thinking that. On the one hand, you can tell that this is a character who is giving a performance, because a performance in a movie is usually, just like a play within a play, is usually not as good as the surrounding material. You're still fooled because of the nature of the material, because it's a movie and this is the sort of thing that could happen in it. But in a sense, it's also playing fair with you because of that. But the clincher, the absolute clincher for me and for John Payne too, that convinces him this is really happening, is in the writing, where she says,
she wanted to kill him.
She wanted to kill him. That's the thing that she can't understand and that makes her feel so guilty. Access this rage that was inside her, and she could have done something else, but in that moment she snapped and she wanted to kill him, because we know that John Payne was feeling the same way when he caught his wife.
Yeah, well, that's the auteur signature for Karlson, for sure. These are good people. Everyone that he shows us as a protagonist is a good person, very likable in so many ways, filled with rage, and definitely capable of killing someone in the wrong situation.
And this is where it also becomes a betrayal, a real betrayal for him, because he has identified with her. He has seen a double of his own situation, and he's revealed something important about himself in that moment. He feels like they've really shared something of importance, and right after that, he discovers that it's all been a trick.
Yeah, the body gets up, and it's a smarmy Broadway-type guy.
And for a second, we're in a Twilight Zone episode, right?
Yeah, or a Frank Capra movie where Mr. Deeds goes around punching all these supercilious aesthetes.
Well, both, but when the body first gets up, it felt like a Twilight Zone episode, one of those episodes where you can't tell whether something is a performance or reality.
And so after he knocks all these guys out, and he wants to knock Evelyn Keyes out the most, but of course he doesn't, because that's not done.
Of course, in Mulholland Drive, by the way, it does an inversion of the usual, a performance in a movie is not as good as the surrounding movie. In Betty's Audition, it does the exact inverse of that.
Well, that's true. So he beats everyone up and runs away.
But they think that's even better.
They're like, oh, I can't believe it. What a publicity break. Now we can have him arrested because he believed the play. It's so good. Nobody's actually even upset. Evelyn Keyes actually says that. You know, they're not mad at you. They just want to use your arrest for a publicity stunt.
And yet I still feel, because it's so identifiable, particularly if you've ever worked in the arts, it's so identifiable, her ambition, this poor working actress who finally gets a break to appear in a starring role on Broadway, right? That I still, when she tells him that she's given it up, it hurts.
Yeah, well, she's really sacrificed something, so she clearly cares a lot about him, too. Maybe a lot more than she realized.
Or it's just the fact that she's actually a good person.
Yeah.
Well, both.
It's all of that. Now, meanwhile, the wife character has been getting up to her own crazy antics. So she's hooked up with this gangster. They've got this big plan. They've stolen the diamonds. They're going to sell them to a fence, take off for sunnier climes.
This is Peggy Castle as Pauline Driscoll. She was Miss Cheesecake in 1949.
Yeah, she's pretty great in this movie. Of course, she's very attractive, but there's nothing likable about her, I find. Her boyfriend is even more repulsive. But at first, he really seems to like her. He likes her so much that he brings her with him to the fence. Now, that's kind of by necessity because they've been seen kissing in the jewelry shop.
One of her redeeming features is that she didn't intend anybody to get killed.
No, but that's more because she's scared about being electrocuted, I think.
All right.
She seems totally amoral to me. You know, there have been so many different things going on in this movie. John Payne's had the big talk with Frank Phelan about how to resurrect the marriage, just whisper in your ear that you want to start a family. He goes to meet her at work to try this whispering technique, and that's when he stumbles upon her infidelity. You think he's just going to flip out right there. He drives away angrily instead, because he knows he's going to kill his wife if he doesn't. That's kind of the impression you get.
Well, she says to the boyfriend that she thinks he would kill her.
Yeah, I mean, he's filled with rage. There's no doubt. So the boyfriend's like, okay, well, let's go to the fence together. Let's get this taken care of right away. And then we're going to get on the boat. We won't have to worry about him anymore. At that point, the plan is still intact, but it all gets foiled by the misogyny of the jewel fence, who operates behind a front of a pet store. And he's like, you brought a woman here. Bad move. Our deal's off. That's it.
He also killed somebody, and that wasn't supposed to happen either. That's causing more trouble for them.
Yeah, but I think he was pretty much not going to do it as soon as he saw Peggy Castle. He's talking very judgmentally about this.
See, you had a way stronger reaction to her than I did. Like I said, as I was emphasizing when we were talking about the beginning of the movie, I actually felt a little bit sorry for her and her frustrated, shallow dreams.
Well, you can, for sure. The movie doesn't bend over backwards to make you really see things from her perspective. Sure, you can understand it intellectually. Why is she berating her husband?
There are worse versions of this character.
And as you say, she is upset when she finds out there's been a murder. She seduced this Dutchman so that they could get jewels from him, but she didn't think his head would get caved in after that. But it did, because Victor doesn't leave anything to chance. He likes a good killing if he can get away with it. So everything goes south. I thought they were just gonna get killed right here the first time I saw it. But no, that's not the way this fence rolls. He just gets them both beaten up and thrown out of the pet store. Now, Jack Lambert plays the jewel fence's henchman, and he is a real piece of work. You can see him in Kiss Me Deadly, but probably his best role is in The Killers. He's always some kind of psychotic guy on the edge of things who is very menacing, and that's certainly the role he plays here. But they have sort of a light touch with people that they decide not to do business with. They allow them to live, but Victor's like not having it.
Yeah, I don't know. It doesn't seem like a good idea to cheat them and then allow them to live.
I think from the fence's perspective, he didn't cheat them. He just didn't buy the diamond. He didn't take the diamonds from him. He's like, go sell them somewhere else, idiot. That seems pretty fair to me, but
that doesn't seem fair to me. He set this whole thing up. No. They had a deal. See, I'm even sympathetic to the gangster here.
This is to just, Victor.
Yeah, this is just cock-blocking.
It's not Victor's fault. They should have killed him. And since they didn't kill him, he should go mental now and kill everybody.
It's very frustrating. Why can't anything just work out in this movie?
So he decides, all right, well, I gotta kill this woman and I'm gonna go back to the fence and we're gonna get our deal done. That's what he really thinks. He's like, don't worry about it anymore. She's dead.
I was trying to remember, what is his motivation for killing her? Oh, I guess that she is upset about this murder that she's found out about.
Yeah, and also he figures that the diamonds can change hands if he can assure everyone that this woman is dead.
The fence says when she freaks out about the murder, it's like connected because the fence said that's why I don't like women involved.
Yeah.
Because now she's going to go blab this to somebody.
She's gonna tell the cops. Anyway, that still doesn't work because the fence is like, you are a complete psychopath. I still don't want to do business with you. But his henchman is not there and he's just a spindly little old man. He can't fight off Victor, and he gets strong-armed into opening his safe and handing over the money. Why isn't the henchman there? Because he had decided to go rob Victor of the jewels. He's like, well, my boss doesn't want them, I'll take them, and I just won't give them any money for it. That's how he does business on the side. Unfortunately, he runs into John Payne. And as we're told in this movie, he's even more of a force of nature in this one than in Kansas City Confidential. He is a heavyweight fighter, and he reminds Evelyn Keyes that he can't just get into fights and get a slap on the wrist. His fists are lethal weapons. You see Jack Lambert beat people up and manhandle them, and then you see him getting the same treatment right after. And of course, Phil Karlson really likes to do that. He likes to show these kind of hierarchies in play.
Well, yeah, we saw that in Kansas City Confidential, as I was saying. John Payne is beating everybody up, but then when the two guys gang up on him, he's powerless.
Yeah, it's like the lion ganged up on by a bunch of hyenas. And here there's just like an apex predator, and it is John Payne. He never loses direct fist fights, and that is actually reasonable because he is a boxer. Although he's one punch to the head away from losing his eyesight forever, which is very stressful to watch as well. So yeah, he just beats it. Everyone's beating information out of everyone, and you can really feel the impact of the fists. Excellent work on that. It's mostly done with sound effects. Not like they're really hitting each other, but it's pretty convincing.
There's a whole lot of stomach punching, which is the ultimate in comic books too. It's like the ultimate in graphic violence.
Yeah, it really hurts. The corollary of Victor's murder of this woman that he doesn't want around anymore is, you know, I'll just conveniently blame it on her homicidally jealous boxer husband. So he stuffs her in the cab, and that's the end of things as far as he's concerned.
Of course, John Payne finds her just as Evelyn Keyes is coming to tell him the good news that she quit her show.
Dead woman in the cab.
She's repented. Yes, and then she has to stick by him after that because she tells him, I'm your witness. I saw you find her, so I can tell the cops that you don't seem like you did this.
Yeah, he's not a good actor. He would have had to be even better than she is to convince her that this was the first time he'd seen this dead body in his car. So yeah, it's a plausible reason for believing him, even beyond the fact that they're falling in love in a weird way on this crazy night. And so yeah, once again, John Payne kind of on the run from the cops, trying to vindicate himself somehow. He doesn't really know exactly how that's going to come about. He figures if he can just find Victor, and he knows from beating up Jack Lambert that Victor's plan is to leave the country tonight. So they have to do it tonight. They can't wait. Adding to the tension is the manhunt that's going on for him. He's being protected by the people at the cab office, who all hate the cops and don't mind lying to them for
that's
a friend.
Right. We didn't mention his other wonderful friend from his boxing past.
Yeah, his manager.
His manager, who won't take him back until he says he's going to go somewhere else instead. And then he will, because he's like, I'm the nice guy. I'll take you to the doctor if you get cut up. These other guys won't even do that at all. They won't look after you one bit. So, fatherly manager. So there's two set pieces that end the movie, and one of them is Evelyn Keyes doing a version of another Hitchcock scene, which is the saboteur try to keep the guy from...
Yeah, or Phantom Lady.
Try to keep the bad guy from leaving, from getting away scene by using her powers of seduction. And this, we see her doing another acting performance, this time as a ditzy, drunk, promiscuous woman.
Yeah, it's kind of a callback in a way to Phantom Lady, right? When she is hanging out at the jazz club.
Yeah, a little bit, I guess.
Not as exaggerated as that, because that's really crazy what Ella Raines does. It doesn't work.
Well, as in Saboteur, it doesn't really work. And maybe she's keeping him there a few seconds more as he tries to get her to fuck off.
Yeah, he's like, yeah, it's gonna have to be never. Get out of here. I just killed one woman. I've got to leave tonight. I'm a psychopath. I'm not easily distracted from my plans here. So she has to just reveal her cards.
Well, again, it's like the saboteurs, where Priscilla Lane eventually has to do that too. She's about to leave. She does try to get him to leave through the front so that John Payne can take a shot at him. Is that what she's doing?
Everything goes wrong in this scene, right? Because he doesn't even want her going in there. But she figures, if I can go in, I can bring him out without maximum difficulty and without you getting a arrested for appearing in public. But nobody figures on him getting ambushed by the gangster, so he's not there. She has no backup at all. That's not what she was figuring on. So yeah, she gets taken by Victor, and John Payne gets ambushed by this whole gang of pet store creeps. who think that he's in on it. Starts to bleed into the Kansas City Confidential situation. They think he's part of the scam, not that he's a virtuous man trying to vindicate himself. And they don't even care. They're like, it doesn't matter, really. We have to kill him. We have to kill everyone. So it's another orgy of violence, where people are constantly sort of turning the tables on one another. John Payne gets away from the gangsters. They all get killed eventually. The last man standing, other than John Payne, is Victor.
Ultimately, he has to take this guy down with his fist. You know, there's a whole internal monologue going on where he starts reliving his big fight.
It's incredible.
We're worried about his eye.
Yeah, I mean, he can't see anymore. He's actually having flashbacks. And we know that there could be an actual physical thing going on there where one of these blows did destroy his optic nerve.
And he's got this monologue going on about how you just have to keep punching and punching and punching and punching.
Yep.
As he's beating this man to death. I can't remember, is it just the cops coming that intervenes and prevents him from beating the gangster to death?
Yeah, and Evelyn Keyes, everyone shows up. He does not actually kill him.
So, I mean, John Payne does get to get his rage out.
Oh, yeah.
Almost with deadly consequences, which, of course, we also see at the end of the Phenix City story.
And he winds up in this great relationship with Evelyn Keyes.
We're tricked into thinking that maybe he's gone back to being a boxer, which doesn't seem like a good idea.
Yeah, but it turns out the camera pulls back, and it's a new young kid who's coming up, hitting the heavy bag. John Payne is just visiting the gym and talking things over with his manager, but he's not going back into the fight game.
Doesn't he own a gas station?
Exactly.
He told his wife he wanted to do, and that wasn't good enough for her.
No.
It reminds me of the car rental fantasy in Carlito's Way. Somebody says that Evelyn Keyes is his partner, so yep. Do you think they co-own this?
Yeah, with Frank Phelan.
Right, right.
So yeah, they're set for life, I think. Things are going
to
be good.
But I wasn't sure. Like, is she supposed to be his financial partner?
Yeah, I guess so. She's a full business partner and life partner.
What does this movie have to say about protagonist relationship to violence?
You know, I don't think it has easy answers for us. Really present someone who is on the verge of lashing out and killing people. One of the most upsetting scenes is not the most traditionally violent of them. It's when Frank Phelan is trying to talk him out of going completely berserk and killing his wife, and he just shoves him. And again, he's so much bigger. Frank Phelan goes flying and hits a car, and it almost looks like his neck could have snapped and he'd be dead. And they really staged that brilliantly, because you can see how near a thing it is that he almost killed his best friend just, you know, because he doesn't want to be comforted right now. It does help snap him out of things when he realizes how close that was.
But also because his friend keeps giving him this cheerful advice that doesn't apply to people who are in the noir hell world.
Yeah, and John Payne does go into that when he and Evelyn Keyes are talking over what the hell is going on between them, and he's like, you know, it's too late for me to find someone that I can actually believe in.
I forgot about that part of the romantic relationship thesis. Well, he gives this whole backstory about his ideal relationship, where he says that when I was a kid, I used to dream about a girl who would stick by me no matter what. And, like, we can tell that by the time he was a grown up and becoming a boxer...
Well, he had all these hangers on.
Well, no, I mean, he had lost that dream, and so he decided to settle for a trophy wife instead because he didn't think such a woman existed.
It's because of the boxing environment he was in, right? That's what he says. He says, whoever won the fight, all the girls were there. And of course, these are the girls that he started to believe are the only girls in the world. And really soured him on life, I think.
But you can understand how he wouldn't believe that someone like, or anyone would believe that someone like Evelyn Keyes existed. This isn't just your standard relationship he's talking about. He's talking about a whole kind of different romantic ideal, which is of this woman who would stick by you no matter, like, what terrible thing has happened to you or that you're involved in.
Yeah, even when there's a police manhunt and you've got a dead wife in the back of your car.
But then he finds out that this is true.
And he's having trouble with the whole concept. And that's what he says to her, that it's too late.
Well,
but
between
it turns out it's not too late.
Between his wife's betrayal and her betrayal, he's having a lot of trouble with that concept.
Which is fair enough. But the movie does bring him back from the brink of all of that and sets him up for a really happy life.
So his rage and his being pushed to the edge almost of murder, that is also the reason that he can identify with this character that Evelyn Keyes was playing. This seems very Lynchian too. thinking about Lost Highway and Mulholland Drive, even if patriarchy makes it so that this type of violence is much more common for men, and we can see the reasons for it in this movie, the pressures that are on men and the expectations for violence that are on men. Nevertheless, it's a feeling that it's a human feeling that transcends gender. When you're pushed to the point where you access the rage that makes you capable of killing someone.
Oh, righteous female rage. That's what my novella Chimera Lucida is about. So yeah, very interesting intertwining of that with Phil Karlson's more typical male rage thematics. What did you think of Evelyn Keyes in this movie? I think she's wonderful.
She's kind of odd looking, and she's kind of odd as a presence, but I was very impressed. It's kind of Naomi Watts' feat. I was very impressed that she was able to give this very unusual, nice girl, but definitely not too nice performance. And then to do such different things as that sexual assault monologue that she's nevertheless playing so that it's not quite convincing, even though it's still very, very dramatic and emotional. And then, doing the floozy routine at the end. I mean, it gives her a really interesting character to play, but also a lot of interesting things to do.
Yeah, I really like Evelyn Keyes. A strange career. I mean, she was a leading lady in the 40s and into the early 50s, but she never became quite as big as you'd think she would have.
She's got a very quirky appearance. Something I did notice, in addition to the exploitative violence, there's an awful lot of emphasis on women's breasts.
She's got a real sweater girl scene at the end, especially, that Victor kind of ignores.
Nice girls do have big racks. That's definitely a good opportunity for her, this movie.
That concludes our John Payne double feature. An actor that I think really helped out any movie he was ever in, but the 50s was certainly the decade that gave him the best opportunities. These two films, Slightly Scarlet, he did a lot of really interesting noirs and westerns. One of my very favorite of the Reagan movies we talked about on Red Time for Bonzo was Tennessee's Partner, which is about the friendship between John Payne and Ronald Reagan's character.
Yeah, I mean, his role here is to be a nice guy who is scary and dangerous.
He's got a Mulholland Drive connection as well, because he was married to Anne Shirley. I remember reading about this when I was a kid. She left him and he was just devastated and crying and a real mess. But anyway, they had a daughter. So his granddaughter is Catherine Town, because the daughter married Robert Town. And Catherine Town is the sort of personal assistant on the phone in Mulholland Drive, who's like, well, you could come over to my place. And she's talking
the one who's making a play for Justin Theroux.
I love that performance. She's so great. Weird little disembodied scenes. Beacon out of the hell.
Do you think that's another deliberate noir connection?
Well, maybe more to Chinatown, though, since Robert Town is her dad.
Well, but that's like a whole intergenerational legacy.
It's a palimpsest.
Suppose we could mention before we move on that 99 River Street, this unique concoction, was based on a cosmopolitan story, Crosstown, by George Zuckerman, who went on to write the screenplays for Written on the Wind and The Tarnished Angels.
Wow.
Two great Cirque films of the 50s.
Very interesting decade for that guy.
Not very much like this movie, though.
No. All right, speaking of quite a different approach, we've got Five Against the House. Leonard Maltin says, 3 stars out of a possible 4. We're seeing a pattern here. Quote unquote, perfect crime caper has 5 friends set out to rob Reno, Nevada casino. Execution of robbery along with gorgeous Novak. Keep this film rolling along. The director, Phil Karlson, and the cast list, Guy Madison, Kim Novak, Brian Keith, Kerwin Matthews, William Conrad, and Alvy Moore.
Oh my god, Brian Keith is the dad in The Parent Trap?
Yeah, he's also Hardcastle in Hardcastle and McCormick, and actually there's a moment in this movie where Hardcastle is threatening the fat man from Jake and the Fat Man, because he's the guy with the cart at the casino. There's a real 80s detective show lineage here.
I used to watch The Parent Trap a lot as a kid. I do have it on our schedule when we do Haley Mills Spotlight, I don't know, 10 or 20 years from now. I did not put that together watching this movie, but now I see it. And now I see his face. Yes, yes. Very different context for that face.
You know, Brian Keith is also the son of Robert Keith, who we've seen quite a lot lately. He's the dad in Written on the Wind.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And the dad in I Want You as well.
Weak dad.
Yep.
Guy Madison, no longer the luscious young boy that we saw in Till the End of Time with being preyed on by Dorothy McGuire. Now he's a needle-nosed weirdo.
He was a household name in the 1950s because of his TV role. Wild Bill Hickok? Yeah, yeah. Is that the name of the show?
The Adventures of Wild Bill Hickok.
Yeah, so a big success there. I mean, he pushed a lot of cereal to kids. When he was in movies in the 50s, they're almost all auteurs, but not here.
So these guys look like a bunch of incredibly middle-aged college students.
By design.
Well, to some extent.
Because they are getting started late because of a detour through the Korean War. This movie does have a lot of the DNA of Till the End of Time, actually. If you want to find Guy Madison auteurism, it's right there, for sure. Brian Keith is kind of playing the Robert Mitchum character, and Guy Madison is once again playing the Guy Madison character.
So these, other than Kerwin Matthews, who's a bit younger, the three stars are all around 30.
Kerwin Matthews, man, what a weirdo in this movie.
Yeah.
This is a really distinctive film.
It is, and it's got a very weird and not very effective structure or non-structure.
I love it.
It's different. It's definitely different. It just totally takes its time to tell its story. It gives no shits about action or tension.
No. It's really taking some chances. And this is the biggest studio out of our four films because this is at Columbia. The other movies were all made by very small studios. Basically, hanging out with four guys, as you say, all of them seem a little bit overripe for law school.
The beginning of this movie felt like you were watching a slightly younger version of, I don't know, like a college movie with the guys from Husbands in it.
Summer is ending. They've all been working out on ranches in California. They're going back to school, Midwestern University.
The guys from Husbands really should have done a heist. That's where they should have focused their energy. Let's do a remake of Husbands as a heist movie.
Well, isn't that what Ocean's 11 was?
You think Ocean's 11 is Husbands as a heist movie?
A little bit, anyway. Although it was before Husbands. All the Rat Pack movies are kind of Husbands with heists. But yeah, this is before all of that. These guys, they stop off in Reno. They're only there for like an hour. And it teases you, right? Anyone that knows a caper movie knows that someone looking at their watch and keeping careful track of the time. Usually that's because they're about to pull something off and escape. Here it's really just, no, we're staying for 1 hour because I want to get back to see Kim Novak in college. This is really just four guys hanging out at a casino briefly. But you start to get a sense of their personalities, and it's pretty funny, I find, the way
that... Brian Keith is doing the Peter Falk role. He's just off on his own seducing women, and you don't initially suspect that he's an absolute psychopath, but he is.
Yes, he is. And Guy Madison's the leader of the group, clearly. You've got the two goofballs who are making more of a careful study of the casino, especially Kerwin.
Kerwin's just a rich sociopath.
Yeah, pointing at where all the cameras are and all of that stuff, but again, it's just for fun. They're not intending to do anything. They're not casing the joint.
He's like John Dahl in Rope, except that he doesn't want to kill anybody. He just wants to pull off the perfect crime.
I mean, he seems like a character out of Big Bang Theory or something, really. Like, it's a really weird role.
Big Bang Theory meets Husbands as a heist movie.
Things take a dramatic turn, though, when just before they're scheduled to leave, a robbery does get attempted. The two younger guys are in line behind the robber, and they get rousted by the police. And again, this is a theme here. These police are definitely ready to take these guys in and start beating their heads in, just because they happen to be standing behind a guy with a gun. They're only saved by Guy Madison, really, coming out and saying, why are you doing this? They didn't do anything. They're here with us. We're going back to college. And finally, the robber is prevailed upon to tell the truth that he's never seen these guys. But again, it just shows us the police are eager to just spread their net wide and beat everyone up any chance that they can get. Not even for corruption reasons. It's good sport. But this does plant the seed much deeper than it would have taken root in Ronnie's mind that he should actually start thinking about robbing the casino. Oh, you're gonna accuse me of robbing a casino? Maybe I should start to figure out a system for doing it. And he's a guy that likes systems. But again, he's likable. He's good with the quips. He seems to be a good friend here. But he just gets too focused on certain things.
Then we've got Alvy Moore, who looks like the other guy in Two and a Half Men. The one who's not Charlie Sheen.
John Cryer.
It's basically the same character, too. I watched a lot of Two and a Half Men when I first moved to Toronto. Toronto and was living in a room that provided, like, a room, like, literally a room, because it's Toronto, it's expensive, living in a room that provided cable TV and a hot plate. And Two and a Half Men, I just always had it on for comfort. And The Big Bang Theory, actually.
Yeah, we're talking a lot more about sitcoms than I expected to.
In a way, it is very sitcom-y. It's presenting all these joking male college students together. They're constantly quipping.
Then they get back in the car. None the worse for wear at that point, except that Ronnie's mind is active now, thinking about, yeah, how could I do it? How could we actually rob? Because the police actually say you could never do it. You can't get away with robbing this place.
Oh, he doesn't like that.
No, there's a way.
They've thrown the gauntlet down.
They have. Nobody else is thinking about this at all. Everyone's forgotten about it. Ronnie, that's all he cares about. They get back to college. We've heard about Kim Novak's character because Guy Madison is eager to get back to her. And then we see her. She has gotten a job at the local cafe singing nights.
Guy Madison looks just like... Everybody looks like somebody in this movie. He looks just like Luke Perry in 90210.
Okay.
In this movie.
Sure, well, another famously a little too old for school performance. But yeah, so he's the one that is kind of on track for a heteronormative life. Get this law degree, get married, that's what he wants anyway. The other guys, they're either goofballs or silently battling absolute insanity. We do find out fairly early on that they served together in the Korean War. Brian Keith saved Guy Madison's life, got a steel plate in his head, just like Robert Mitchum in Till the End of Time.
Robert Mitchum's steel plate doesn't give him rage issues, though.
No, it just makes him really, really ache and be really irresponsible and just want to die of alcoholism. But no, Brian Keith has even bigger problems than that. But as you say, I mean, he seems very breezy at first, and all of this is carefully concealed until they are at this soiree. Again, he's doing his smoothie hit on the girls act, and he's got this ex-girlfriend that he wants to rekindle things with. She seems kind of interested in it as well. She's there that night with a guy that is paying much more attention to Kim Novak, so she's annoyed by that. When he realizes she's out there talking to Brian Keith, he wants to start something, and that's not a good idea. He's not big enough.
He's also not insane.
No, he gets beaten up pretty quickly.
Brian Keith immediately goes into a rampage.
Well, not immediately, right? He does try to stay out of it. He's like, don't crowd me, you know, but it's like, don't make me angry. It's like the Hulk.
No, it's don't get me started from Wild Oranges.
Because he knows once he gets started, he's going to go into, I have to garrot this person and rob them of their lives. He doesn't want to start. They force him. It's like Rambo. Why are you pushing me? That's where it goes, though, and only the intercession of Guy Madison and a whole crowd of onlookers prevents a murder. Then they bring him home, and, you know, the seriousness of this is really brought home to the viewer. Everyone's trying to pass this off as, oh, he just had too many drinks. He'll be fine. Don't worry about it. But Guy Madison is deeply concerned and does everything he can think of to convince Brian Keith to go back and see the doctors because he's not well. No, he doesn't ever want to go back there. Again, this is what Robert Mitchum says too. I'm not going back to the doctors. Guy Madison's trying to talk him into it. I mean, it's a very direct link between those two films. Here it's just turned into a heist movie instead. But the way it turns into a heist movie is so crazy. I mean, there's no other movie like this.
At a certain point, once Brian Keith's insanity just takes over the movie, it started feeling like it's really a two-hander between him and Guy Madison, and Brian Keith is just like his double, like a suppressed part of his personality. Like, this is just one person, the part that can function and the part that can't.
Yeah, I agree. It's almost got a bit of a Roadhouse feel to it, too. I mean, Brian Keith is a little Jeffy-ish. He's got this deep friendship with Guy Madison, although the movie doesn't go the same way because the friendship is not broken by the insanity somehow. And again, that's Phil Karlson showing us once again his optimism, really.
His humanism?
Yeah. None of these films, I mean, they're all perfect setups for nihilism, and none of them go that way.
No, like I said, there's a wide spectrum presented of good to bad to people in the middle who are flawed or desperate.
It's a really long buildup to the heist, and so much of it doesn't seem like anything you'd expect to see in a film noir. There's a lot of walking and talking with Guy Madison and Kim Novak about whether their relationship has a future to it.
Right, she's not sure that she wants wants to get married at this point.
She's also very frank with him in saying that, you know, she's been involved with lots of guys before who seem just as serious as he does, but as soon as they graduate, they're gone.
Yeah, and he points out, but I'm over the hill, and I have, you know, some experience under my belt, so maybe I really am serious.
Yeah, I think it's really nicely done. I really care about their relationship, and you kind of have to get the most out of the crazy thing that their wedding trip turns into. And I think Kim Novak does a great job in this movie, and this is a very early part for her. If you look at her filmography, how early is it?
Her fifth movie, but in two of them she was uncredited.
Right, so yeah, this is maybe her first starring role as a protagonist, anyway. This is
right before Picnic and then The Man with the Golden Arm.
Getting revved up for greatness here. And yeah, I think she really comes through. It's not an easy part to play. She's really stalling things for a lot of the movie. You see why she's doing it, but you also believe Guy Madison enough that you want to see them together. You can see that he is the only level-headed person out of his crew, and he could really use something to pan out like this for him. It's just like, are these guys gonna screw it up for him? And they really try hard.
We want to go for an auteur spiritual autobiography here with my premise that these two men are just two sides of the same person, then if Guy Madison is actually going to go on to get this law degree, graduate from college, and marry Kim Novak, then that makes Brian Keith the character who's closer to the artist.
Right.
The one who knows, I am not going to get that fucking law degree. That's not going to happen in a million years.
Yeah, he says that. You guys can only carry me so far. I'm not going to make it. You know it. Everything is so contingent in this movie, and that can seem bad, I guess, if people don't like randomness in plots, but to me, I really love it. I love the way this all comes together. You've got various different neuroses all combining into a perfect storm of craziness.
This plan with this tape recorder in the cart is absolutely insane, and we know it's supposed to be insane because Ronnie came to the club initially with a perfect gambling system that didn't work. So yeah. His perfect systems don't work.
Yeah, but this one did, right? I mean, he really did think it through. And that is something to keep in mind at the end. This definitely would have worked if they hadn't been completely dysfunctional as a gang.
Well, this is the thing, like, the human element, he's not taking the human element into consideration.
No, he doesn't really reckon with much of anything that's human. Yeah, so his single-minded focus on this casino in Reno spills over and just totally activates Brian Keith's mind in an unexpected way, and he kind of takes over the heist and the crazy plan somewhere along the way. Of course, you could see it coming a little bit, but even when I saw it the first time, I was like, how is this going to turn into a heist movie? How are these guys all going to get on board with it? I think they came up with a really fascinating way to do it. The two most neurotic guys out of the four, their ailments somehow coalesce.
Impossible to understand why L.V. Moore is doing this, why Roy's doing this at all. He really is a nihilist.
Whatever.
So it's not a, like, as a portrait of a generation, you have a PTSD psychopath, a wealthy sociopath, a nihilistic idiot, and upstanding Guy Madison.
Yeah. That's your typical friend group.
One out of four is gonna become a functioning contributor to society.
And maybe not even him, if his friends have their way. But yeah, fortunately there's Kim Novak in the picture. Very level-headed. Part of that level-headedness is a reluctance to launch herself in marriage that may be premature in her mind. But she does settle all of it, and I do like the way it all comes to a head. It's quite dramatic. Like, well, fine, can't make up your mind, going to Reno with my pals. And that is a fateful decision because there was no way for them to force him to go, and Brian Keith was definitely getting a little bit sad there that they're gonna be three. How's that gonna work out? The plan calls for four. They gotta have the fourth guy. They're on the verge of getting the guy they've been hazing to have to bring him in. But no, Guy Madison's like, no, we're going. They get an added gang member when Kim Novak decides the die is cast. I'm coming too on the trip. Crazy trip because they don't want to be seen filling up their gas tank. They don't want to get any food anywhere. They have to be completely incognito the entire journey from the Midwest to Nevada, and so everyone is just eating pre-packed sandwiches and pissing in bottles or something. I don't know what they're doing. What Kim Novak is subjected to on
their
this trip.
Their ride is a lot smoother than Lucy and Desi in the long, long trailer.
Well, this is the small trailer. But yeah, they do talk about how they're committing a misdemeanor. by being in the trailer while it's moving.
And this is the 50s. It is indeed trailer time.
Yeah, you can use it to climb mountains. You can use it to rob a casino.
You can use it to perform a heist. You can use it to ruin your marriage.
Somewhere along the way, it eventually gets divulged what they're actually doing. It's when Guy Madison recognizes the cart that has been concealed with a tarp and finds that there is a recording in it. We still don't know exactly what this recording is supposed to do. I've seen this movie a few times. The reveal of what...
It is an absolutely insane plot.
You know, they have it out on the highway. Guy Madison finally just basically has to agree because otherwise there's going to be bloodshed. There are guns on him. Brian Keith is completely mental at this point. He's past the point of no return. Been building for so long. Everyone's telling him he has to go back to the hospital. He doesn't want to go back to that Foucauldian nightmare. He wants a whole bunch of thousands of dollars so he can run away to some island and just lie on the beach and no one will crowd him and he'll be fine. That's what he's hoping for.
I mean, that's fair enough.
Yeah.
Are they going to fix him? He went to Korea. He's fucked up now.
Like, he's got a plate in his head.
He doesn't deserve to be in a mental hospital. Those are awful places.
Yeah, of course, you feel a lot. I mean, Brian Keith does a great job in this movie. He is really good.
He cannot function in society. It's just not going to happen.
No.
I mean, the ending lies to us and tells us it's going to be okay, but...
Well, we don't know. We don't know. We have to hope. And I think the movie does give you some reason to hope.
But why would he want to function in this society that has been presented to us?
Well, that's another question. But, you know, we have to try. That's the thing. Not because we believe in it, but because it's better to have a good life or a comfortable life than a bad one. They're all kind of press ganged into this. At this point, nobody wants to do it except for Brian Keith. Ronnie's like, what have I done? Starts to reckon with the craziness of this whole thing. He's not completely sociopathic all the way down the line. He just doesn't think through the...
He didn't want to kill anybody again.
No, there's not supposed to be any guns. And he's like, we talked about this. And Brian Keith says, you better believe there's guns. I mean, we need guns all the way to Reno to make Guy Madison stay here. That's not going to change once we get into the casino. If people don't buy that, then they're not going to like this movie. But to me, it all makes sense while you're watching it that they have to do it. And they figure, like, if they could disarm Brian Keith, he's probably going to get killed.
They never even seem to consider that.
Well, he's the only one with a gun.
Yeah, I know, but they never even seem to consider that. They just all seem to be kind of shell-shocked.
Well, I would be. I don't know what I would do.
Crazy. Even if you disarmed him, he'd go wacko and try to beat you to death.
Yeah. So they figure, I don't know, maybe we just have to go through with this, let him have some money or do something and get away from him. And I don't know. They don't know. And again, that links this movie up with the first two. I mean, the end game for the real protagonist, I guess you could say maybe it's Guy Madison and Kim Novak. They have no idea what's going to happen or what they're doing. By the end, they're just in over their heads once again, and they go through with this perfect scheme, and it works. It is planned out to the last detail, and the last detail is the threat of a dwarf with a gun in the fake cart that they bring in. So instead of switching a flower truck, they switch in a casino cart that has a tape recorder in it that gets pressed at opportune moments. A psychopathic dwarf with a gun. He wants to kill you, so just give him a reason.
He's not talking backwards, though.
No. And that's William Conrad, as I mentioned earlier, from Jake and the Fat Man. I don't know if people watched that. At least you probably did not. He's also one of the killers in The Killers. Anyway, he has a good little role here. They really apply the pressure to him. He's sweating a lot. And who wouldn't be when they're confronted with a bunch of guys in fake mustaches and cowboy garb and a purported dwarf in a cart?
He's just gonna come at you. He's just gonna start biting your ankles. Just gonna gnaw them right off.
Brian Keith does all the explaining. So now you're asking yourself, why am I gonna go in there and not call the cops? It's because there's a little guy in here.
No, it makes no sense.
It does make sense.
No,
are you going to take a chance that it's a tape recorder? Why would you?
Why would you think there was a little guy in there?
I would.
You would think there was a little guy.
If the result of being wrong is getting shot, I think I would believe it.
Well, he ends up throwing the cart into the middle of the room.
There's a guy with a gun in the cart.
So as far as he's concerned, this dwarf could just blast everybody to death.
He just breaks at that point. I mean, he's just completely having a meltdown. And I guess maybe he figures, I don't know if I can upset the cart enough. People can subdue the dwarf before he shoots. But yeah, he's definitely taking a risk. But by that point, our gang is already out of the casino and they could have escaped easily. It's just that they fall out because nobody even wants the money except for Brian Keith, and they start trying to stop him. And then you have this long chase, but it's such a different chase from the end of 99 River Street because Guy Madison is trying to get to his friend to talk him down before the police, the trigger-happy police, get there and shoot him. Because again, that's what they love to do. They're not interested in reforming anyone or extenuating circumstances or war heroism.
But it really seems like Brian Keith is going to just end up shooting Guy Madison.
It does, but that's not how the movie goes. And this great friendship brings him back from the brink. And Kim Novak is watching with bated breath as well as this all plays out, thinking there's got to be a better way for a marriage to start than this. But ultimately, it is a pretty life-affirming ending. Till the End of Time also ends with Robert Mitchum getting wheeled into an operating room, and maybe they're going to fix the plate in his head a little better this time too. So many links between the Dimitrik film and this one.
Or maybe Brian Keith is just going to end up in that psych ward for life.
It's possible. And the war machine created that situation. But Guy Madison did save him from the bloodthirsty Reno cops. The Phenix City Story. Well, it's a clean sweep. 3 stars out of 4 for Maltin on the Phenix City Story.
He just thinks there's no difference between these movies at all. They're just all 3-star, solid 3-star movies.
Fast-paced expose film, compactly told.
Fast-paced other than the long documentary intro, but maybe that wasn't in the version he saw.
With realistic production, fine performances, as lawyer returns to corrupt hometown, tries to do something about it. Sometimes shown without the 13-minute prologue. The director, Phil Karlson, and the cast list, John McIntyre, Richard Kiley, Catherine Grant, Edward Andrews. So here we get a lot more directly sociological, for sure. What did you think of the prologue?
Weird. It was excessive even for a film of this type. It goes on for a very long time.
Establishing the bona fides of the story and the real people that were involved in the case.
Yeah, and also the film uses many locals.
Yeah.
In it as extras, and from what I've read, also in speaking parts sometimes.
A couple of them do. Like Ma, the old lady that runs into the crime boss on the street, she is an actual citizen of the town.
Jonathan Rosenbaum thinks, although he doesn't seem to have any evidence for it, also that the woman at the hospital who makes the reveal about the body also seems like a local. He grew up in Alabama during this time period, and he says, I mean, he was on the other side of the state, but this movie seemed to him to be real Alabama, real urban Alabama, that this opinion was shared by other people he knew who saw the movie.
This was a big hit.
Yeah, it was made while the events were still unfolding. The events of the investigation into this murder. And the film, according to Gareth, contributed to John Patterson's political career. Karlson liked to boast that he got him elected, which doesn't seem to be anything much to boast about. So John Patterson, like the heroes of this movie, were very much whitewashed. The liberal politics were injected into the movie, let's put it that way, particularly the racial angle. And that is what makes the movie much more interesting and seem like a subversive, concealed social commentary about more than the not particularly interesting problem of political and gang corruption. Vice.
Yeah, running games of chance that are not games of chance and beating anyone up that has a problem with it. Killing anyone that has a problem with it.
That's dramatically interesting, but it's not, to me, that sociologically fascinating.
No, the way it does Trojan horse race issues into the picture is quite skillful.
Sidney Poitier turned down the character of Zeke. Apparently it was a decisive moment in his career, turning down this character. He talked about it a lot. He didn't like the fact, and this is fair, he didn't like the fact that this character didn't do anything about his child's death. And it's because they're attempting to Trojan horse these race issues into the movie, but they're not willing to make this character on the same level as the white protagonist.
No, that's true.
He doesn't join the fight directly, although he ends up harboring one of the people who is a main protagonist.
I mean, he does join the fight when he trips the guy that's about to...
Yeah, but then we don't see him again for most of the movie until he does come back for a very important moment at the end. But anyway...
It's not a leading role. Sidney Poitier was a leading actor by that time anyway, so you can see why he would turn it down on those grounds as well. Although James Edwards did star in at least one film.
Yeah, clearly not the leading man that Sidney Poitier became. So what ends up being interesting about it, I guess, is the same thing that Rosenbaum finds interesting in it, is a sociological portrait not of a city fighting against gangsters, but of the South. All sorts of things are sneaked in here, like the idea of vote suppression, feeling of having a culture that is run by the Klan.
Grim stuff.
So the actual murder of the little girl, that was fictionalized.
But of course, murders like that had happened plenty of times, but just not in this town, maybe, and for those reasons.
Yeah, not associated with organized crime, but with the Klan. In terms of who smuggled these issues in, like, obviously Karlson was friendly to the idea, but we do have a gray-listed author who worked on the screenplay.
Yeah, Daniel Mainwaring.
Gareth mentions him as being a blacklisted author. His Wikipedia page contests the idea that he was blacklisted. And I mean, obviously he's working, so he wasn't blacklisted, but maybe graylisted, and that's why he's working on a B project, even though a big B project. The Wikipedia page says that there was confusion and maybe he actually fronted for a blacklisted author. But if you were fronting for a blacklisted screenwriter, that meant that you were friendly to their ideas anyway.
Presumably, sure. Yeah.
There had to be a network for fronting.
The main screenwriter was Crane Wilbur.
Yes, he did the research, but it ended up not being entirely faithful.
No.
And partly because, well, Gareth says you couldn't make a melodrama out of what was actually going on in the city because it was really complex and you could not divide people into good guys and bad guys. And also, to some extent, people didn't know what had happened because it was still unfolding at the time. So fictionalization was the way to go here.
But the movie does gesture, at least, towards complex issues, right? And in a way that is in keeping with Karlson's oeuvre as we've been examining it. The righteous rage of the vigilantes is definitely interrogated here as well, not just the violence of the gangsters. Got the Pattersons trying to counsel the best way to fight vice without succumbing to homicidal rage. Most of their interlocutors seem willing to do. And of course, that brings to mind all the other ways in which vigilante violence was brought to bear upon people for much less noble reasons than ridding a town of vice.
Rosenbaum, in his essay, brings up the zeitgeisty ending, theme of the ending, that rhymes with Martin Luther King Jr.'s approach to civil rights movement.
And nonviolence.
Also, segregation had become a political issue. It had been declared non-constitutional already, and the ending also seems to be prescient in the employment of martial law that was ultimately necessary for ending segregation.
Yeah, this is 2 years before Little Rock. Now, there's a long history to this, too, and it's interesting. It may not seem exactly progressive in our eyes now that people are cheering the arrival of the military to impose martial law, but you have to remember that this has deep roots in the South as well. Reconstruction, after all, was an attempt to enforce the enfranchisement of freed slaves, and the only reason it worked at all for a little while was because of martial law for 12 years. So that's what people would have been thinking about as well in the background. In addition to the fact that Brown versus Board of Education had been decided by the Supreme Court, separate but equal had been ruled unconstitutional. Eisenhower was being encouraged by progressives to use the federal government to enforce that. It hadn't happened yet though. So what had happened here was National Guard troops sent in to protect the sanctity have this by-election that has to be undertaken because John McIntyre gets killed.
And when we see the violent means of voter suppression, that's going to ring racial bells too.
Yeah.
Also the fact that John Patterson and his wife are presented as getting back from Germany, and he makes a point of saying, well, the fascists are here too, I have to fight them here too. Now that this was not true of the actual John Patterson, he had been in Korea, he had not been in World War II.
He never was stationed in Germany later, because...
I don't know, something I came across here said that at the time he was coming back from Korea.
Okay.
But regardless of the factuality of that, the point is that that makes a link between fascists here in America and, again, segregation and the Klan and the Jim Crow era.
Yeah, absolutely.
We also just get this hyper-exploitation film atmosphere that Rosenbaum found so accurate of really banal Southern sleaze. There's no glamour here at all. Vice. It's not like there's a glamorous or demonic noir world within the small town. The vice and the small town folksiness, these worlds are completely intermingled. Though there is a suburb that you can escape to. That's what the initial plan is. John Patterson and his wife are going to raise their kids off in the burbs. They're never going to have to worry about 14th Street. They can just pretend it doesn't exist.
Yeah, I mean, this is a pretty unique situation, even though there would be echoes of it in towns all across America. The reason that Phenix City is set up the way it is because it's a sister city to Columbus, Georgia, where there's a giant military base. All the soldiers come across the bridge, the Chattahoochee River, I think they say, and that's basically who's getting swindled in these casinos and vice joints for the most part. It's not really the citizens of Phenix City that are getting taken advantage of. It's U.S. soldiers who are lonely and horny and stupid getting robbed, vampirically drained of their wages by the syndicate. And that's been a workable situation for a long time in the town because everyone's benefiting out of this for the most part. The only people that are getting tired of it are people that are squeamish about the fact that they have to beat up and kill the occasional soldier who gets out of line or anyone else that happens to come in and doesn't like getting cheated at cards. I mean, they should know that that's what they're in for when they go there.
Okay, so this was from a film comment article that was talking about what John Patterson was doing right before the events of the movie. It says, looking at the record of the real John Patterson, we find some holes in the fabric of the Phenix City story's scrupulous realism. The film has it that John is freshly returned from prosecuting war criminals in Germany, which allows the script by noir expert Daniel Mainwaring and Crane Wilbur to draw an analogy between European fascism and the strong arm tactics of these Dixie brown shirts. In point of fact, he was really returning from Korea. And then it goes on to talk about how he was not particularly friendly toward desegregation once he was in office.
Yeah, well, I don't think there were too many elected officials in Alabama that were at the time, so that rings much truer than the portrait we get in this film. Of course, we've seen that in the other three movies too. All of them show a very violent world with every reason to despair, but they want to pull you out of that.
Speaking of Mainwaring being a noir expert, what that refers to is his...
Out of the Past?
Yeah, well, he also wrote the novel that Out of the Past was based on, Build My Gallows High, and the screenplay. I guess that's the main one, but he did the screenplay for the original version of Invasion of the Body Snatchers, so that's a good paranoia, 50s paranoia movie.
Oh yeah, that's a noir sci-fi film for sure.
Something else emphasized in some of the things I read here, particularly in Rosenbaum's essay, is this character of Tanner, the head honcho.
Yeah, he's the banality of evil.
Yeah, exactly. How he's just presented as a sort of actually kind of likable guy, but a very normal guy anyway.
He's a businessman.
Yeah.
We meet him as he contemplates the possibilities of turtle racing. Well, these are cute little guys. We could have them race. Doting on some of his employees. He's not grossly hitting on women. He seems to have a relationship with his second in command.
The manager or whatever she
is. Yeah, but other than that, I mean, he's not groping everyone. He's just doesn't like trouble.
Well, I think he has taken advantage of his position to have this relationship, but he's not as gross as he could be.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, he's really just trying to run a business here. His friends at the sauna are also just businessmen for the most part.
They're good old boys, as Rosenbaum says.
They don't want to kill anyone. They would like for things to just run smoothly, and they just wish everyone would stop getting so excited about Vice. He genuinely seems to want to maintain a good relationship with his old school chum, Albert Patterson, John McIntyre.
Who, when we meet him, is tired of trying to reform the city. He's hung up his cape.
Yeah, yeah. So, great. As long as he does that, no problem. He can defend members of the syndicate in a one-off case. He can do whatever he wants to in terms of taking cases, but he really should not consider entering any kind of an electoral battle over Vice in Phoenix City. McIntyre has no intention of that. He is pretty settled. They shake hands, and he's not going in with them either, and he could have a very lucrative opportunity, but he's like, no, I'm not taking your part, and I'm not fighting you. I'm just my own man in my office, and I'm gonna run it with my boy, and we're gonna stay out of all of that craziness. Tanner's fine with that. He's not strong-arming him in any way. He's trying a little sweet talk, because he thinks McIntyre's a good lawyer, but that's it. So yeah, I agree. I think that is a very chilling portrayal, because when he finally does say, okay, it's time to give them, what is it, the full treatment? And the full treatment is go and kill this girl. I mean, that is an absolutely mind-scarring scene.
So the idea here, yeah, this is up there with Sam Fuller's White Dog, in terms of, you know, exploitation movies finding an effective way to portray racial violence.
Yeah, they really hit a nerve.
The idea here is that they are going to kill the little black girl because she is disposable by their lights in order to frighten the white people that they might move on to doing this to their children.
It's a message to the most distinguished family in town, according to the movie, the Pattersons, who your first move can't be to kill one of their kids. You have to give them one warning, and this is it. After that, the next step in the full treatment is clearly, yes, we're gonna have to kill your kids too. And this is Zeke's daughter, and Zeke had made himself an enemy of the syndicate just by tripping that creep who's gonna attack John Patterson.
By throwing his lot in with them.
Yeah.
So we see her skipping across a bridge, and then some huge looming guy just comes up to her and asks, aren't you Zeke's little girl? And then she screams.
What an absolute nightmare.
And there's nothing to prepare us for this at all.
No, just Tanner giving the word to begin with the full treatment.
The next thing we see is her body is being thrown where the Pattersons are. The wife is there with her little children. One of them's in a playpen. It's very obviously a fake body.
Sure.
Being thrown. And I'm interested, we can't know what the intention behind that is. The effect of it is a welcome distancing, as far as I'm concerned.
But it also emphasizes
how
the lifelessness.
Dead she is, yes. And how thing-like she is to them.
Yeah, and they absolutely melt down, as you should.
They go
when you see a dead body like
absolute
that.
Hysteria, which makes sense. But it's like a Twin Peaks scene. Like, everything is completely hysterical, justifiably. But then we do get a horrifying close-up of the little girl, bloody and twisted. The wife is just inside yelling at her husband that they need to leave, and the children are screaming their faces off. They're clearly traumatized for life.
Yeah.
Like, nothing is ever going to undo this.
Hard to see what could be done to assuage this sense of evil. But John Patterson is like, gotta keep fighting. I'm really decided now. We're going in, we're gonna get this syndicate, but we are getting you out of town, honey, and little honeys.
She does end up proving her mettle as a Phil Karlson heroine. Well, she's not the main heroine of this movie, but a Phil Karlson partner by coming back, although she leaves the kids with grandma.
Yeah, well, that's very smart. Why risk the kids, too? I mean, they're not gonna have a lot of fun family evenings in Phoenix City anyway, so you're not losing much there.
I don't think the kids want to come back to that lawn or anything like that.
No, I'm surprised they only went to Georgia, man. I would go much further than that. But I guess that's where grandma is. And the syndicate doesn't seem to have a reach that extends across state line. They're protected, but now the men are really taking their lives in their own hands by continuing to oppose this machine. And yeah, Ellie Rhodes is the other very important female figure in the film. We meet her very early on. She's working at the casino or whatever you call it, roadhouse or
club.
Yeah, club. And she is just a nice girl. This is the only place in town where she can make a decent living, and she is going to stick it out there.
She's supporting her family.
She's involved with a young man who is on the side of righteousness. His father is one of the leading citizens who's always trying to get these clubs closed down. Tanner's like, well, why shouldn't they be sweet on each other? They're two healthy young people. He's not itching to bust this up or kill this guy. Unless he starts making trouble. But I guess his second in command can see more clearly than he can that Ellie is a problem.
Well, she's also jealous of her.
Yes, there's that too. Ellie is played by Catherine Grant, later married to Bing Crosby.
Yeah, I don't know if she was instrumental in getting the funding for Walking Tall later.
Liberal values related to race in this film do seem to continue into Walking Tall.
Right.
So that is certainly something that you don't tend to see in those 70s vigilante movies.
So yeah, so there's a lot of warring, we've talked about this with many directors, there are a lot of warring political tendencies happening with this director, but he does seem to be consistently progressive on race and gender.
Yeah, because Ellie Rhodes is really the protagonist at certain points in this film. She's the one that overheard the plot to kill Albert Patterson and really throws her life away trying to warn everyone about this, and once it's done, try to stay alive so she can testify. And now she fails and gets killed by Tanner.
Yeah, it's interesting because the movie does have definite good guys and bad guys. So in that sense, it follows a typical melodrama pattern. The big bad guy, as we've been saying, is just presented as a businessman, not a sadist.
No, he gets pushed over the edge and murders Ellie Rhodes with his bare hands at the end. And he seems freaked out by the fact that he's done that. All for nothing anyway, because he's going to get beaten up and indicted.
Another unusual element about it is that good guys can end up dead.
Yeah, definitely. And it's like Game of Thrones.
Three do. We have a little girl, Ellie's boyfriend, and Ellie.
Yeah, and the dad.
Oh yeah, of course. He's shot in the mouth, which apparently happened. But we see it.
Yeah.
We see a perspective shot of him being shot in the mouth.
Yeah, John.
This genial old man.
John McIntyre.
Apparently he was wearing the suit of the actual Albert Patterson for that scene. For God knows what reason.
He really got into the character, clearly. He's an excellent actor.
So this movie has two acts of violence that eyes should never have seen.
Blood everywhere in this movie, which you don't see in many even violent film noirs prior. Like Anthony Mann noirs, I don't think you see blood in the 40s.
We saw a lot of blood in that crazy Wild Oranges fight that I was talking about.
Yeah, but that's silent era.
You think there's more blood in the silent era?
I think so. In that one, yes. Anyway. That final confrontation, everything that plays out at Zeke's house. Again, I think we agree Sidney Poitier was right. This is not a role with enough stature for him. It's maybe not the right politics for him.
It's not a protagonist role.
No, but I do think James Edwards does a good job in his role.
It's crucial. And it's interesting because he ends up, it's like the traditional role of the woman to intervene in male violence.
Well, and that's lampshaded or directly alluded to by the fact that his wife had first done the service for him because he had intended to kill and was talked out of it by his wife. And then he does the same thing for John Patterson.
It's transferred over to this racial issue, which draws a link between the oppressions.
And John Patterson talked back from the brink. He definitely wants to beat Tanner to death. And the only thing that stops, so just like Brian Keith and just like John Payne, I mean, it comes close. But if he had, he probably wouldn't have been electable. Although, I don't know.
In this case, though, this is like the one case out of all these movies where I'm like, just let him kill him. I did see one write up on a noir site about Karlson's movies that said that the movies were very simple-minded, like their protagonists, and that the protagonists usually solve their problems by using their fists, which kind of seems like the opposite. I mean, I guess it's technically true to a certain extent.
Well, no, it's not true. I don't think it's true in any of these movies.
You don't think it's even true in 99 River Street? I mean, he does stop the gangster with his fists. That's what he has to do.
Yeah, but a lot of it is luck. All of these protagonists are in over their heads. And that's the thing that I see as the most adamantine link between all four movies. That and the unexpected optimism that they show in a very violent, cruel world. Never feel like, oh, this is a superhero who's going to go in and just solve everything by beating everyone up. It's just random chance that the person we're following winds up surviving because they're not strong enough to do what they hope to do with their fists, certainly. And John Patterson doesn't even talk like he wants to, unlike some of the other characters. I mean, he doesn't need to beat Tanner up at the end. There are a bunch of adults there that could subdue him.
No, he's just pretty angry that Ellie got murdered.
Yeah, which is reasonable, but a good idea not to follow that out to its logical conclusion and allow yourself to murder someone when you don't have to.
Well, that was the whole point of Evelyn Key's speech, right? In 99 River Street. Didn't have to kill him. I wanted to.
Yeah, you shouldn't give in to that.
So, I mean, I think the non-violence theme is a real ethical issue in the movies.
Yeah, it's a message of non-violence conveyed through really startlingly ramped up levels of violence.
I know. I mean, it's always the case with movies like this or like David Lynch's movies. We are drawn to the movies by the violence. And we are fascinated by the violence and to some extent enjoying it and to some extent being horrified by it. But yeah, I mean, obviously the reason you like these noirs so much is that you would say of them, as you would say of David Lynch movies, that whatever attraction the violence has for the viewer, it's certainly not the only thing going on in the movies.
Well, we'll close the book for now on Phil Karlson. I hope that you've enjoyed this ramble through four of his best films, and definitely someone I would encourage you to explore. We could do some other ones. Tight Spot is a cool movie, too. There's a lot that I haven't seen, actually. Certainly none of his 40s movies. So if we can find them, maybe we'll do it. Phil Karlson, the early years.
Yeah, see if he's correct that these are some of the worst movies ever made.
Indeed. Next week on the podcast, Universal, 1943. How's this for a double feature? The Strange Death of Adolf Hitler and Son of Dracula.
Oh my.
Looking forward to that.